I wonder if any of you have ever been in love. I'm not going to ask you to put up your hands. I just presume that most of you have been, even if it was a long time ago. Sometimes, maybe it was very recently, sometimes people talk about being in love as a kind of madness. And maybe it is. You know, I think there's a whole lot of chemical stuff going on in the brain. When the mist clears, sometimes we might get a bit of a shock at what we've done, what we're sitting in front of. But in fact, I think that the only way to see truly is to see through love. Some things are only known truly when they're loved. In the end, I think perhaps most things. People, for instance, people are only truly known when they are loved. Otherwise, they risk being just objects or means to an end for us. I am just filled with a sense of horror about the story of what happened to that little 5-year-old Indian girl, and some of you will be aware of that, others perhaps not, but I won't go into the details of that. But that little girl, a little girl, has been just treated abominably. If she was seen with the eyes of love, that would never have been done to her. You could not hurt somebody whom you see through the eyes of love. But without that, we are always at risk of seeing each other as an object, as a means to an end, as an obstacle. And we don't see the truth. People are only ever truly known when they're known through love. Not the madness of being in love, perhaps, so much, but even there I think there's a glimpse of the beauty of people we don't otherwise see, but the deep, profound reality of love. And God even more so. I read and spend a lot of time reflecting on a very beautiful book called The Cloud of Unknowing, written by an anonymous author in the 13th century. He, among many other spiritual writers, says, but he says very powerfully and very succinctly, he says, God can't be grasped by knowledge. God can't be known, grasped by our intellect. God is so supremely, vastly beyond the capacity of our minds to grasp. But, he says, and this is extraordinary, he says, God can be grasped by love. We, small as we are, tiny as we are, in a sense, against the infinity of God, so vast beyond all capacity for us to know, can be seized by our love. God can only be known through love. Just as, in fact, this is more profoundly theological than I have time to spend on now, but we are only known to God through love. It's not so hard to see. God is love. God knows us through loving us. And we know God through love. The Trinity we worship, that in whose name we begin every prayer, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, know each other too through love. God is a communion of love, love beyond our capacity to understand or imagine. Deep, profound, radical, welcoming, totally giving love. It's that communion of love that is the God we worship. And so we are led by the one who on this Sunday we call the Good Shepherd into that communion of love. The sheep that belong to me listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. We are led by Christ into the communion of love, where alone we can know the truth of God, glimpse it. Where alone we can know the truth of each other and the truth of creation. Outside of that, everything falls short. But in that profound communion of love beyond our capacity to understand, the Father and the Spirit are one. As this gospel ends, the Father and I are one. it doesn't mean some sort of physical interpenetration that our minds might think of in ordinary terms, but the deeper, profounder, extraordinary, infinite, absolute unity of love. In that unity of love, Father, Son and Spirit, the Father and the Son are one. And through the Son, we're invited into that same depth of communion of love. By baptism, by the Spirit, nourished by the Word, sustained by the Eucharist, we are gathered into that unity and communion of love where alone we can know truly God and each other and ourselves. Out of that, no truth can be truly, finally known. And even within it, it's an inexhaustible mystery that we will continue to discover through all eternity. What does that mean for us? Well, it means something about the way we come to our faith. We use our minds and hearts and emotions and words and all the things we have to assist us towards this moment of love, but they are not in themselves the moment of love. They are, as another image goes, I think an Indian one, they are the donkey we ride before we enter into the temple, where everything that brings us there is finally abandoned as we enter into the experience itself. So our discipleship, our baptism, this word we hear, this Eucharist we enter into, continually calls us to conversion. The first words of Jesus in Mark's Gospel, repent, convert, turn around, the kingdom of God is close at hand. A conversion from attention to ourself, from being entrapment in our mind alone, from a focus on our own capacities, to profound abandonment and welcome to the gift of love that calls from us a response of love deeper than our mind, deeper than our emotions, deeper than our heart. This radically deep part of us invited in response to love in return. That's the heart of the gospel. That's the heart of discipleship. That's the beginning of eternity, the glimpse of heaven open to us even now and offered to us in a very special way in the Eucharist, in a very particular sacramental way. In this sense, then, we are led by the Good Shepherd into the deepest truth of all. But it calls for us, and I don't know how to put this into words. I don't know how entirely to do it, but it is a kind of abandonment of ourself, something of the image of the cross, a throwing ourselves and all of our capacities finally away till nothing's left but a welcome to God and a deep, profound, radical yes to the God who comes to us in love. To give everything we know and think about ourselves up in order to discover the truth of ourselves. Now, just to end, that's not about a selfish focus on our own self-improvement. It's not about an eternal experience of navel-gazing. Because this conversion to love opens us to see all things truly, God and others and ourselves. And when we see things truly, we see them in love, through love and with love. So the kind of things that have afflicted our world this week, the horror visited on that small child, the terror of Boston, all the lostness of people damaged by others for their own purposes cannot happen from a heart of love. When we see the world truly immersed in this event of love, which is God's own being, then we cannot help but move toward each other in love. Treat each other not as objects, nuisances, or means to an end, but as the beloved to be honoured. The world is transformed into what Jesus proclaimed as the kingdom of God.